Yeah. You can start.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So, I think you've seen the mail that I circulated and Rija shared with you. Today, we're going to be talking about East Asian IR theories and also the Chinese theories of IR and how the case studies within China are then simulated via certain theories which are both Western and non-Western in nature. So I'll begin with East Asian IR theories particularly and the context in which this whole idea of regional IR theories emerged. Now, in the previous two lectures, we've seen that the post-Cold War literature on IR basically had a lot of discussion and debate regarding conceptual misfit of conventional IR assumptions regarding the so-called third world. And third world, the category that was basically used to denote erstwhile colonies and also the developing countries later part of the last century. And there were questions raised with regards to what, if anything, does East Asia or a certain region mean, and whether they can, I mean, the particular region can tell us anything about a general social science theory or an IR theory in particular. So many scholars like Alistair Ian Johnston, Lebethall, all of them, some of the readings that I've also shared with you, reviewed this, the scope of IR theories in that sense, and tried to bring in certain contexts which were very specific to certain regions. In this case, we are going to be looking at East Asia and literature related to East Asia, dividing it into basically three important clusters of theorizing. The first one would be basically structural theories about the neglect of this region, in the sense of rising power and the kind of conflict that was visualized in East Asia particularly. And the way it was juxtaposed with the nature of conflict and the nature of rising powers in other parts of the world. Now, this was interesting. The juxtaposition that was done vis-a-vis East Asian region was primarily in the context of transatlantic IR theories, which is what we can say as, the realist schools of IR and the liberal school of IR. Now, this was not just in terms of a specific regional data problem, but it was also certain acts of omission and commission which downplayed the explanatory power the explanatory variables in context of East Asia, and therefore the kind of theoretical arguments that emerged in that particular region, which was making these scholars revisit this notion of whether a certain general theory which has its context in some other, in some specific part of the world, is enough to explain and explore contexts of different regions. And there's been a very fairly strong claim in East Asian IR literature that East Asian institutions, for instance, are under-institutionalized or less legalized than those of Europe. So in this particular example, you can see that how the institutional weakness and the very design of institutionalism in East Asia was actually put in direct contrast and comparison with, say, Europe or the US. And to sort of put a scale which is already made in some other part of the world and try to see that whether East Asia fit into that kind of a scale was the guiding norm. So many scholars pointed out that perhaps the terms of the scale, the notions that you put into the making of that scale, were not really what captured the actual essence and nature of, say, the institutions in East Asia. So ASEAN way, for instance, of institutionalizing became a very heavily explored area. I mean, initially ASEAN was very much pit against the European Union, and whether ASEAN was another vibrant organization, exactly as a prototype model of European Union or not. But later on, it was seen that certain specificities were very unique to East Asian and ASEAN model. And therefore, this comparison, this constant comparison in terms of what an institution should be, whether it can start wielding power, whether it can have certain influencing norms and value structures, was something that emerged in case was something that emerged uniquely in case of ASEAN and was not necessarily a mirror image of what was happening in European Union. So the contrast of ASEAN with EU, for instance, was something that was later on discouraged, and it was suggested that the idea of institutions has to be explored in terms of their local contexts as well, and therefore a general, their connect with a general theory of institutionalism should be able to bring in the kind of insights that these local contexts have with regards to a general theory of institutions. So that's just one example. Now, also in the case, as I said, about the structural theories about rising power and the nature of conflict, the ideas of world war and the experiences of world war were very much rooted in a large part of the Western Hemisphere. Even though you had Asian power like Japan, which was a part of that entire eventful first half of the last century, it wasn't as if the context of the world war had emerged in the non-Western part. So therefore, the nature of conflict of that nature and of that scale was something that was specific to the Western world, and therefore the kind of conflicts that had unfolded in the post-colonial world was also something that had to be looked at with a fresh perspective. And all of these things pushed and suggested towards this conceptualization of international relations theory, changing the location of international relations theory in that sense, and bringing in different underdeveloped and developing regions in its fold. Now, so far as we've been talking about the problem of large N networks, which is basically where you try to repeat a certain experience by positing a general theory, the idea and the amount of work that has gone into peace and conflict studies and the way theory has been simulated time and again, the Western theory of conflict and the Western theory of peace, the way it has been simulated time and again, in the context of East Asia, has for the most part, what the East Asians actually complain is that it ignores memory, it ignores ethnocentrism, it ignores the specific contexts of historical nationalism, and therefore their prognosis of foreign policy, preferences and behaviors of the state, the nature of state system, is basically subordinated to transatlantic theorizing. So you basically import the theory of nationalism, import the theory of ethnocentrism, import the theory of self-determination, and also import certain vestiges of Western memory of war and peace when you try to explain East Asia. And this is something that should be rectified. This is something that should basically be revisited. And perhaps there are certain nuances that need to be basically thought of. Now, this idea of ignoring memory is really interesting because this is the term that basically emanates from East Asian IR theories. An ignorance of historical memory of East Asia. Now, when you contrast it with other parts of non-Western world, perhaps this term ignoring historical memory has been replaced with, say, the post-colonial context or the subaltern context. Now, instead of post-colonial and subaltern, what emerges in East Asia is this historical bias against East Asia by the Western powers, the historical bias of having made overtures of certain beginnings or having made overtures of controlling East Asian territorial expanses. At the same time, the overall play, the overall imperial play of power by Western countries was not in the same manner as it was in other colonial parts of the world where colonies emerged. So it wasn't direct colonization, and many a times it was not even direct imperialism. The extent of power and the nature of power in that sense differed. But that is not to say that there wasn't a historical memory of exploitation that was created. And to negate this particular historical memory of exploitation, subordination and power accumulation in East Asia by Western powers is something that these IR theories deliberately do, And therefore, the scholars from East Asia basically protest against that and try to therefore do away with this a priori ruling out of national or regional schools of theory by Western scholars. And this is what they mean by transatlantic theorizing, neglecting East Asia while trying to talk about East Asia. Now, at the same time, there are certain cautious or certain rules of caution that have been basically put forth in the sense that East Asian IR should not be viewed as a self-contained monolithic discourse, nor is it an intellectual enterprise which is purely aimed at, say, the production of grand theories. Now, even the question whether there is an East Asian theory of IR has been hotly debated amongst East Asian scholars and also by the scholars coming from outside the region. And many times this proposition is put forth that rather than theory in the sense of advancing testable observations about how the international system operates, it may be better to attempt a description of a host of Asian IR approaches as perspectives which make a better sense of the world, not just in East Asia, but outside of East Asia as well. Now, certain scholars coming from, say, other parts of Asia, for instance, if we just take the example of India, you have people who have attempted an understanding of international relations theories from, say, South Asian perspective or West Asian perspective or East Asian perspective or even specifically Chinese or Indian perspectives. And they have pointed out to the idea that it is less interesting to put forward any monolithic theory, rather than it's more important and more beneficial to be curious about how the world is viewed from a particular location. And in fact, many scholars like Bahira and Malavarapu and others reject the notion or the attempt of creating an Indian school of IR because they primarily point out towards the concerns that such an undertaking could result in some kind of self or other binary that can simply pit, you know, the Indian IR or Chinese IR or self against the Western IR, the other. So that's basically a very broad concern that that has been raised regarding the construction of any unified schools of thought, which risk creating grossly simplified and polarizing categories, which may end up supplanting one dominant body of knowledge with another. And such similar sentiments also pervade the debates on Chinese school. And many scholars remain skeptical about the feasibility of a single school, which may not actually be able to represent the diversity of Chinese perspective. So to say that, to put it all together and say that, is there an Asian theory of IR or is there an East Asian theory of IR, again, you know, makes us look into this whole monolithic construct of East Asian or West Asian, or let's even say Western theory of IR. So what comes out of this debate, and which is what actually proves beneficial out of this debate, is the idea of conceptual pluralism, which is perhaps in a better position to serve the original intention of actually the non-Western IR theorists, which is basically to bring diversity back into the study of world politics. Now, following from this, it is also important that we don't overstate the difference between Western and Asian IR approaches. Indeed, a commonality of thread, a commonality of attributes and the natures of Asian and Western approaches lies in the kind of normative qualities that they propose and their interest into how the world ought to be. Now, much like Western IR theories, Asian perspectives have very deep-rooted sources in political thought. So the knowledge of political thought emanating from Asia is very crucial in terms of trying to contextualize the IR theories coming out of Asia. In many cases, it is also a matter of transposing theories of statecraft, state, society, human nature, individual, to global realm. So how you look at all of these categories within East Asian context has certain ramifications at the global level in terms of theorizing regarding state, society, and human nature, and individual, and statecraft, and governance, and that's it. Just as Enlightenment era philosophers like Thomas Hobbes and Locke were very crucial to the development of IR theory, ancient and modern scholars and philosophers from East Asia are equally relevant. For instance, from China, if you were to take the example of Confucius and Sun Tzu, and from Japan, if you were to take the example of Shiratori Kurakichi and Nishida Kutaro, you get an insight into the important process of inspiration for Asian traditions of knowledge. And the elements of Confucian thinking, for instance, on power, order, statecraft, etc., can be distilled from how China conducts its foreign policy today. And the importance of maintaining harmony and stability to safeguard the global order is very much a Confucian concept that remains a popular dictum in China. Similarly, the notion that to wield power, a state must shoulder commensurate domestic and international responsibilities, and this is one which basically defines China's contemporary identity as a responsible stakeholder. So many a times, verbatim quotes from Confucius's work and from the works of other Confucian scholars have been basically invoked by the Chinese state to justify certain policies and to basically present its future visions of responsible stakeholder at world level. Now, it has also, the basics of Confucian thought have also served as the basis for corresponding responsibility thesis of China, which advanced the notion that China has certain unavoidable duties and obligations as a rising power, particularly with respect to managing and securing global order and stability. Now, scholars like Liu Fatung have pointed out towards this kind of study and have brought in the context of rising power, which is going to be different from what has been sermonized as the idea of rising power in the Western theories and Western literature on IR. Similarly, if one was to take the example from Japanese IR, the kind of unique contribution that comes from the extensive works of celebrated philosophers, including, I took the name Nishida Kitaro, who was actually the pioneer of Kyoto School of Thought. He has been often labeled as proto-constructivist due to the prominence he gave to cultural factors and identity construction. Nishida advanced a philosophy of identity for addressing a fundamental Japanese conundrum. Now, this question has been asked time and again with regards to even Russia in that case, whether it's an Asian power or it's a European power, and whether Japan belongs to East or the West. So that kind of a conundrum has been basically in some sense addressed by Nishida Kitaro, and he adopted a dialectical approach, arguing that Japanese identity existed and exists within a coexistence of opposites, Eastern and Western. So this coexistence of opposites within quotes by Kitaro is instrumental in consequently allowing Japan to cultivate a universal appeal. And scholars like Inoguchi, who have worked since 2004, 2007, I mean, many articles and works have appeared by Inoguchi, which sort of extrapolate from this proposition of Nishida Kitaro and accord Japan with a special role in world as it is positioned to encourage both Eastern and global awareness. Now, this argument fits with Kitaro's broader vision of a multicultural world where true world culture can be achieved only through the recognition of both cultural differences and the union of these differences. And scholars like Krummel have pointed that out in their studies. Now, coming to South Korean IR scholars, for example, one heavy influence by mainstream IR in that sense within South Korean IR scholars has been the focus on addressing certain issues, certain world issues from a realist perspective. So as opposed to Japanese and Chinese IR scholars, or influences of Japanese and Chinese intellectual thought on their respective IR traditions, South Korean IR scholars, on the other hand, have been heavily biased and influenced by a realist school of Western IR. And in that sense, the rationale behind responding to both the Japanese and the Chinese within the region has been from the perspective of realism. And to build a response, these IR schools in South Korea basically try to represent better the Korean ideas and interest within a very much American-dominated discipline. It is, however, possible to divide the Korean scholars working in the pre-1949 period and during the period after 1949, also through the 50s, 60s, and 70s, and therefore, consequently, also after the opening up of China, the way there were two camps that emerged in South Korean IR scholarship, which basically started looking at both the regional specific context of South Korea and also its traditional military and strategic affinity with America. And in that sense, two camps emerged there. And it was basically the basis for a critique of both a critique as well as a reiteration of the development of an alternative perspective from the region. So therefore, if you look at this brief overview of how East Asian IR in that sense developed, it tends to exhibit a greater degree of conceptual fluidity and also context specificity. So these two particular unique features, conceptual fluidity and context specificity, are something that in practical term translate into instances where Asian IR has made certain noteworthy contributions to what is known as middle range theorizing. Now, middle range theorizing is again not a grand meta-narrative of a theory, but it's not something which is as micro or as specific in its context as a perspective. So the form, and I'll give some certain examples in this case. For instance, the formulation of fact-driven theories to explain a specific real-world phenomena, and also something that came to be known as by the Western world as a soft IR theory. These middle-range theorizings from IR refer to policy-driven theories informed by the thinking from foreign policy approaches of Asian leaders. Now, Vary Buzan and Ashok Acharya and Amitav Acharya have worked a lot in that sense in this case, and they have normally relied upon the specific generation of policy prescriptions from East Asia, and as well as the insights into the factors that motivate the foreign policy behavior of Asian states. One of the influential middle range theory is by one very renowned Japanese scholar called Akamatsu Kaname, which is basically Flying Geese model of regional development. So we know that the focus of world political economy basically shifted to East Asian hemisphere, East Asian sphere based in the 80s and 90s started shifting, and it was very much located in East Asia post the turn of the century. And Flying Geese model is basically a particular model of regional development which is used to explain this particular shift. And the theory not just explained Japan's economic leadership within Asia, but also served as a rationale behind the country's economic assistance to developing countries. So for instance, Japan's ODA, Official Development Assistance, and the rationale behind it was very much explained by Flying Geese model, whereby the lead geese in that Flying Geese flock serves as the leader of the geese and goes on about directing the development and growth of that particular flock. And Kaname posited this theory in the 30s to explain how a developing country could catch up with the industrialized West through their interactions. So there was also a lot of regional cooperation, a regional momentum to development that was posited in this particular theory. And we see that with Japan's rapid industrialization from late 19th century onwards and economic development of other East Asian countries in the post-Second World War period, Japan was depicted as a leading booze in a V-shaped formation comprising of emerging Asian economies. Now, here Japan helped to stimulate the regional industrialization and economic growth by passing down its older technology and know-how to economic assistance program to other developing countries. Subsequently, it wasn't Japan which was the leading goose, but it was actually South Korea, and which was again subsequently replaced by China. So this flying geese model has been known to be one of the examples of middle range theorizing from East Asia, and which is very specific to this part of the world, and gives us a glimpse of what East Asian theory or might be all about. Now, coming to the idea of Chinese IR theories and the status of Chinese IR in that sense, again, it has not been any less debated than the existence of East Asian IR. In fact, certain scholars like Gerald Chan, who initially started studying the Chinese IR theories, proposed in the last decade of the previous century that there is no specific Chinese IR theory, but the theorization within China regarding how the world ought to be is at that point in time could be construed as semi-peripheral school of thought within IR, and according to Chan, it would become a major school of thought in some decades. Now, this was a prediction that he made in 1999 in his initial work. And it has proven to be true to a certain extent, that we still see the unfolding and coming out of Chinese theory, as it were, in the global context of international relations. And the construction of Chinese school of IR theory became a national preoccupation and resonated very strongly with China's global aspirations. And we saw a proliferation of scholarly work coming out from China with regards to applying Chinese discourses, Chinese political thought, and Chinese intellectual traditions while postulating certain key concepts of international relations. And this also saw a lot of influence and the coming back or resurgence of Confucian heritage in official rhetoric from the Chinese government. And Chinese IR scholars were increasingly turning to ancient Chinese political thought for insights that transcended both time and geography in context of China. Now, although developments since late 20s in China tell us that there have been early attempts to build a Chinese school, the 20s were just initial baby steps in that sense, and the more important and prominent piece of work started emerging only from 1950s, with the kind of focus that was given to academic debates regarding learning from West and also rejecting certain Western notions of development and trying to chart out one's own distinctive Chinese approach. So Chinese approach to development, to modernization, to poverty alleviation, and the whole impact of socialism and Marxism in China's understanding of the worldview was something that marked this kind of a schism or this kind of a specific location of China outside the world of Western IR. Now, this shift crystallized with the kind of rift that was experienced in Sino-Soviet relation during 60s, 70s, and 80s, whereby the Soviet Union's approach to IR was officially denounced by China or within China, and a particular dictum regarding specific brand of socialism with Chinese characteristics in that sense came to be invoked upon by the Chinese state and the Chinese government. And a lot of work regarding Chinese characteristic of looking at things, the Chinese way of looking at things, started emerging slowly from that point in time. Now, the late 80s basically saw a more clearer picture of division between Chinese scholars who favored Western IR approaches to a certain extent and those who pushed IR theory with Chinese characteristics. So you have Maoist scholars like Liang Shaode, who argued for the rejection of Western theories and development of a Chinese model instead. Subsequent debates emerged in early part of the current century in 2000s, which basically largely centered on the hegemonic status of Western IR and the need for Chinese scholars to challenge that hegemony in the face of China's in the face of an attempt to carve out specific place for China in world politics. So the notion of establishing a school, a Chinese school, was replaced. Basically, establishing a Chinese school replaced the more ideologically driven objective of theorizing with Chinese characteristics. So Chinese characteristics became secondary in that sense, and Chinese school became more important at the turn of this particular century. Now, Chinese school is also something which came in the wake of what was known as Beijing consensus by Western scholars, the attempt of, as opposed to Washington consensus, and the attempt to carve out a niche in world politics in that sense. And this whole project of China, Chinese school, basically came to be defined not only in opposition to a prejudiced IR discipline, but also in the light of the challenges faced by China as a rising power within an American-dominated globalizing world. And Wang and Hang and some of the scholars which have worked a lot in the context of Chinese school of IR pointed out towards this necessity arising out of China's developmental needs and so on and so forth. Now, according to one of the more known scholars from China, Qin Yaching, a theory of rationality postulated that states as social actors should base their actions on the nature of the relation that they have with others. Now, the logic of relationality thus was dictated as an actor who tends to make decisions according to the degrees of intimacy or the importance of her relationship with specific others. This was something that came out of a Chinese school of thought and came to be one of the dominant guiding lights in terms of China's foreign policy postulations. And therefore, Qin Yaching remains a very important scholar in that sense. And theory of relationality is something that has now been studied and investigated more from the Western scholars' point of view when it comes to trying to understand China's international behavior. Now, it is said that the theory of relationality put forth by Qin Yaching and others in Chinese school is basically founded upon ancient Chinese philosophy that emphasizes the importance of respecting and behaving in accordance with hierarchy of relationships. That is, example, the emperor and heaven, king and subject, father and son, and therefore draws a lot from Confucius's idea of concentric circles of how social behavior and social relations are actually established in this world. Now, there is a sort of reference to cosmological stability also in this whole case of how the importance of respecting is placed between all of these relationships. But particularly significant is the relationship between two opposite forces. Now, what are these opposite forces? According to Chinese, ancient Chinese philosophy, yin and yang, which is basically supposed to govern all other relationships. Now, the existence of yin is seen as a dependent on yang, which effectively makes them two complementary halves of the whole. So there is never a separate other in this context. Every time you try to balance something which is perceived as the other, it transpires that the other is actually very much located within the self. So the very existence of self is vis-a-vis the other. So this is a kind of notion of inclusivity, that each of a pair of opposites is actually inclusive of the self and other binary, is something which is central to this whole idea of Chungnyeong, which is the middle course. So every time you make a particular proposition as to what can be the state behavior in a given situation, the proponents of Chungnyeong basically talk about the middle course, so the middle path. And this also came to be known as one of the prominent models of China school. And middle course suggested that opposites have the responsibility to give rise to positive interactions with each other, and therefore maintaining harmony and not conflict as the state of nature. So this is interesting for all of those people who are interested, who are actually trying to look at the idea of how individuals exist, vis-a-vis each other, vis-a-vis society, and vis-a-vis state. And there is an interesting idea of inclusivity of opposites within the state of nature. And this is very deeply rooted in political philosophy emanating from ancient traditions in China. Now, the theory of relationality I elaborated upon in such large detail because this particular theory provides us with the insight into how contradictions can coexist and how their coexistence is necessary to functioning relationships. Now, this is not something that we come across in most of the Western IR school theories. Considering how world politics has been viewed as an operative of ambivalent relationships where states can be perceived as ally one moment and threat the next, relationality in this context becomes a very useful theory to give a different path. Now, I had mentioned that today we'll also be discussing about theory simulation. So theory simulation is something that I'll try to bring in this part of the lecture itself rather than keeping it at the last, because we are talking about theory of relationality and the middle course. I would like to bring in the example of the relationship between China and Philippines. Now, we know as a very brief overview of the relationships that political ties between these two countries have been long-standing, but they've been frayed because of competing territorial claims over chains of islands and atolls in South China Sea. So a lot of us basically start looking at South China Sea and try to see the kind of conflict which is ever present there, the kind of nature that can be accrued to this particular conflict and the territorial conflict, and try to sermonize as to what would be the future behavior of the actors or the states involved in this case. Now, these territories are supposed to be important because of the valuable gas deposits and strategic importance that they represent. Now, both China and Philippines have become quite vocal in their attempts to assert ownership over the islands since long. And for instance, in 2016, we saw that Philippines won basically an arbitration case that concluded that China had no legal basis or historical claims to South China Sea. Now, Chinese government strongly rejected this permanent court of arbitration's ruling, and speculations soon emerged of an eventual military conflict between the two countries. Yet, no military conflict has occurred, despite a lot of animosity on both the sides over this issue. Economic relations between China and Philippines continue to grow. So there's no lull in the economics between China and Philippines. On the other hand, the escalation of military conflict has also not occurred. Now, if one wants to basically bring in theory of relationality here, or the perspective of relationality, political tension and economic cooperation constitute the Sino-Philippine relationships opposite others. And according to Chungnyeong concept, one may assume that conflict is not unavoidable within this relationship. If anything, military conflict would constitute an aberration of the status quo. Sometimes that is costly to both the sides. And such a prospect could serve to compel China and the Philippines to seek out new avenues for conflict resolution. So therefore, the emphasis is more on cooperation rather than escalation of conflict. And if you look at the Chinese white paper in 2017, which was published, reaffirming China's claim in South China Sea, there was a reiteration of Beijing's commitment to settling the dispute via negotiation and consultation and bringing in conflict resolution mechanisms rather than an escalation of military sort of solution to this particular conflict. Now, relationality concept here is interesting because it also tells us a lot about the kind of contradictions that China has with other countries in the same region. So, for instance, you have the Japan-China relationship, and you might want to sort of use this particular theory, simulate this theory in terms of explaining what's actually happening in Japan, between Japan and China, because a mere reiteration of a neo-realist kind of a theory about what are the stakes and what are the interests doesn't tell us too much about what is the actuality of a relationship between China and Japan. And many a times, very different explanations are actually brought forth by applying these certain theories emanating from this particular region. So theory simulation in this regard is interesting. And this is just one example. Now, of course, that is not to say that other theory cannot be applicable here, may be applicable. But when we can see a larger degree of acceptance and a larger degree of likelihood in that sense, when one tries to juxtapose one theory simulation and to another theory simulation. And this is how you sort of look at what is more viable. Now, I'll ask you to hold this thought and basically maybe try a certain theory simulation by the end of today's lecture. I'll move on to essentials in research on China. Now, all of us have been trying to try to look at China in some context or the other. What I have as certain suggestions is a mixture of some of the insights that one gains from engaging with China for the last decade, and also some of the rule of thumb in that sense by certain scholars who have worked a lot in terms of looking at the field work in China or looking at China closely through very detailed research designs. I have a book, in case some of you are interested, I'll be happy to share an online copy of that with all of you. And this is something that helped a lot for me in my PhD. And this is something, this particular book would prove useful in terms of if you are looking at China specifically as your research interest. Now, one of the most simple things that perhaps one should follow, and this is not just vis-a-vis the essentials in research on China, but generally research, is when you choose a particular case study, say China, or you choose a particular region, say East Asia, a detailed planning is required. So your research proposal should be ready before you actually start moving towards the field. And not just the research proposal, but certain parts of your research should be ready. They should be handy. So you have to have an extensive survey of literature where you try to include literature emanating from different locations, from both the Western and the non-Western world, so to speak, from both the field and outside the field. So if you have China as your field, you basically include scholars from China. You also try to include scholars from that region because this particular state, this particular country is not without a particular context. And then you also move beyond that region and you bring in the extra regional considerations to be able to sort of maybe draw a more holistic picture of the research puzzle that you're trying to solve. So there is planning that is required in terms of entering into the field. Now, the other thing that is not very thought upon, but is very crucial, is that one must prepare oneself for a very different online existence. So by different online existence, I simply mean that you might be used to certain social media platforms and networks while you're working from outside of China. But it's also advisable that you get into this mode of accepting the social media platform within China. So one should try to integrate as much as possible. It's not just VPN by which you would want to tune in on to certain social media which are not present in China, but also their own, getting into their own social media platforms is an interesting and a useful exercise of getting to know the society as a whole. So if you're trying to interact with your Chinese counterparts and colleagues and peer group, it's always useful to have a new online existence, to be a part of their social media platforms, to start familiarizing oneself with the way they exist online. Now, the third thing that I would like to point out is how you might want to revise the way certain scales of comparisons work from work in that region and the way they work outside that region. So for instance, a very commonly used scale, a rating scale that we come across is Linkhart scale of rating, which is basically from 1 to 5. And the respondents basically talk about a response to a particular, in response to a particular question, they say they use either 1 as total disagreement and 5 as total agreement, and you know, put 2, 3, 4 as varying degrees of agreement and disagreement. But this kind of a scale might not be useful when you're going to say China, because the way you culturally accept this kind of a school, strongly disagree or strongly agree, I mean, these being the options for the respondents, may not be very viable for the Chinese respondent, because the way one perceives strong disagreement or strong agreement is very different in case of China. So many a times scholars want to point it out as the difference in cultural values. Now, I would say that this is also a difference between systematic, this is a systematic difference in the way one commonly answers a survey question format. So you have a measured effect of the China included Eastern culture when you say that a Linkert style rating from 1 to 5 or 5 to 1 can sort of tell you about the consumer behavior or can tell you about an individual's acceptance of a particular policy. It's very dialectical in the context of the Chinese audience. So one recurring theme that comes across while trying to use such style questions and such style questionnaires is that when you make friends with them, when you familiarize yourself with the interviewee, the dictum that they often repeat is that the nail that sticks out gets struck. So there's this non-acceptance of sticking out. So you don't want to say strongly disagree or strongly agree in that case. And Eastern individuals, or I mean, whatever is the identity that you're trying to understand, whether it's consumers, it's political actors, it's intellectual class, they are averse to extreme opinions in that case. So whereby your understanding of that middle course comes in, that it's very deep-rooted and you might simply answer somewhere in the middle, somewhere in the mean or the median of the entire proposition. And it's likely not to differ from majority. So this basically can only change when you are asking them to evaluate certain new concepts which are already not there. So they might have a different opinion regarding this. But if it's a concept which is very much in common parlance, or it's a concept which is very much a mainstream debate, you might not expect a very outside the mean sort of answer. Now, there's another thing within this entire strongly disagree and strongly agree conundrum, which is that a Chinese respondent is most likely to be very polite, and that kind of a politeness bias might exist. So research participants, when you meet them in China, are very polite and very positive about anything that you want to test. So even your research design is very acceptable to them. to the point that they will encourage you about the concepts that you're trying to use and will be very positive and might not really out of politeness give a strong disagreement. Strong agreement is also something which is hard to come by in that sense, unless it is something which is very resonating of their own opinion, very much reflective of their own opinion. Now, that is not to say that this is a very, this is a very generic observation from my side, but it's not to say that this is the picture. You might find very different experiences when you go to the field yourself. And it's just that this can also be one of the likely patterns of your interaction with the Chinese research participants. Now, this is where it comes, it becomes important that one is very familiar with the cultural terms that are used, and they can prove to be very, very handy in terms of interacting with the Chinese audience. Specifically things like ta qi or pa qi, I mean, the terms that are used to define the nature of a particular thing, whether you're a powerful, masculine, strong individual who's trying to project power through wealth, or whether you are powerful, masculine, strong individual who's trying to project power through physical and physicality and capability of the individual being. So these are the terms that are sometimes used to define a certain concept, the nature of a certain concept. And therefore, an idea of the cultural, terms in that sense, which are very prevalent in common discourse, is always very advisable. Now, there is also that there is also this fact that successful research in China would be at different levels of interaction. So one possible way is a formal institutional affiliation, where you become affiliated with a local institution in China. That becomes an interesting and an important level of doing research. The second is informal and collegial, where you basically start using your personal networks, which is also known as sometimes the practice of Quanxi, which is relation networks. And the concept of finally the mutual benefit, that you basically forge a benefit with your peer group in China based on this concept of mutual benefit, where you help them to conduct certain research and they help you in turn to conduct your research. Now, out of all of this, interaction level, one thing that can be kept in mind is that there is a strong presence of the state. Your interaction at any of these three levels might actually be regulated. Therefore, the question of access to your materials comes. And for that access of your material, perhaps the best way is good collaboration, and good institutional collaboration is the most safe bet in that sense. I have circulated an article by, not really an article, but a chapter by Kenneth Libethal in the readings, and you might want to look at that, because he's basically tracing the trajectory of the changes that have come in research on China, where he talks about how sources were, how sources of your research were basically limited in their location and access in the 50s and 40s, but 60s and 70s saw a lot of elite politics emergence and a lot of ideological battles being fought out in public discourse. And therefore, a lot of studies about differing prospects of reforms and bureaucratic organizations emerged. And you see the change of the topics, and you see the shift in the whole discourse and the research in China through the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s. And today, post 2010, Chinese politics is something which is very hotly debated. And mainstream topics of political science literature are now a very recurring theme within even the Chinese discourse. So this kind of a location and changes of changes in the research in China are something that Libethal talks about. He also talks about multiplicity of the sources. The data source has multiplied in every way. In 80s, you just had formal top officials giving certain memoirs and writing something which might be very revealing in nature. But later on, Chinese media also diversified. You have a huge social media network today, where you can also get an idea about the impulse of the general Chinese audience, the general Chinese individual. And now you have publications of all types in China, coming from state units, coming from ministries, local government, central party school, central committee party history office, and so many other sources. So there is a proliferation of the sources of data. And that's interesting in case of research on China. Now, very briefly, and this is my last bit for today's lecture, because after this, I'll invite you to do, if you want to, attempt theory simulation or case study simulation in that sense. Simulation simply refers to methodology of creating an artificial representation of a real world system in order to manipulate and explore the properties of that system. Now, this is a standard definition of simulation in research methodology. And many researchers basically noted that computer simulation can provide approximate solution to certain mathematical problems, which may be of interest to social scientists. Now, you have examples of paradox of voting in that sense, where you try to predict the outcome of certain voting patterns amongst voters. And you have certain simple models of voting behavior, which are derived through simulation. You also have a lot of simulation that was done during the time of interwar years and even during the war years. And in terms of Arab conflict, you have a lot of simulation, theory simulation in IR, which tried to predict that whether US would have liberated Kuwait had Kuwait not had extensive oil reserves and so on and so forth. So this is an interesting method within IR to sort of look at how theory is connected to actual reality and how certain propositions can actually be now proven through computer simulation or simply by way of simulating theory into practice. So I'll stop here and I'll request you to raise questions.
Hi, Ritivisha, can you hear me?
Yes.
Am I audible? Hi, Preksha here.
Yeah, Preksha.
So, yeah, my question is not particularly on this session.
Okay.
Because this is your last day of this lecture series. I just wanted to know the importance of theory in research in general. Because, for instance, I'll tell you about myself.
Yeah.
My research is on strategic partnership, which is a concept.
Sorry, I missed that last word. Strategic partnership.
Yeah. So this is a concept that's not IR, but it's borrowed from commerce. So because of that, my center or my professors, we are reluctant to research. So I wanted to ask you, does that affect the quality of research?
Your voice has been breaking, so I'll just try to rephrase your question. I think you asked that how important is theory?
Yeah.
In research in general, and yeah. Since your work is on strategic partnership being a term coming from primarily commerce,
yeah,
and not too much from IR, and therefore there is a reluctance to accept this as a viable. Okay, include any theory here.
Yes. So does that affect the quality of research not having a theory?
No, I'll just ask one question by way of clarification from my side.
Yeah. Yeah.
You are reluctant to use any theory in terms of trying to look at strategic partnership, or there is a discouragement from...
yes, there is a discouragement, as in my center generally does not use a theory. Like none of our students have theories in our research. So I wanted to know if I'm to apply abroad, because abroad usually when I went for my fieldwork, they were insistent on a theory. So I wanted to know, does that really affect the quality of research not having a theory?
At the outset, and I'll take questions one by one today instead of clubbing them together, because I can give some time to each question in that case. First of all, the term that you're using, the conceptual category that you brought in your research is strategic partnership, and it's very much a part of theory in IR. Now, if from neoliberal perspective, you look at strategic partnerships, it's basically that partnerships between actors are forged on the basis of institutional frameworks. They
right.
are based, they are forged on the basis of certain ramifications of cooperation, So right. if you cooperate, there are going to be multiple sets of beneficial arrangements that the states can enter into. And some of them might be intended consequences, some of them might be unintended consequences. That's just simple one example of how
right.
it's very much a part of theoretical discourse in IR. Now, this is not just limited to liberal, neoliberal institutionalism in IR or functional institutionalism in IR, but it is also very much a concept of neorealism, because neorealism tried to answer some of the problems of realism by saying that war is inevitable, but sometimes war is deferred for a very long time. And this deference of war or conflict is on the basis of the kind of arrangements that the states enter into. Now, one of those arrangements that states might enter into is that of strategic partnership. Now, strategic partnership is just one way of describing the nature of relationship between two or more states. And this is just one phase. So there might be basically comprehensive strategic partnership. There might be a division in the kind of strategic partnership. So you may call it strategic economic or strategic political or strategic military partnership. So you basically have white papers and agreements between the states based on this kind of a notion of partnership that they have. So this is one example of how neorealist school makes use of the concept of strategic partnership. And there's another example, if you want to look at how constructivists in IR have been asking about rallying behind certain multilateral organizations, not just multilateral, but sometimes bilateral organization, I mean, bilateral arrangements give rise to multilateral organizations. And the term strategic partnership has been invoked a lot in constructivist settings in that case. So to say that it's a term coming from commerce discipline. Commerce is not a discipline in that sense. It's an applied knowledge at best from right. economics. And there's been a lot of derivative strength coming from economics to commerce. And I doubt that we can say that the term strategic partnership emanates from specifically commerce in that sense.
All right.
Yeah. So I would like to doubt and debate that particular thing.
Okay.
Now, importance of theory for a research. Unless you're trying to see what is a theory. Theory, we said that it was basically a postulation or a systematic representation of certain facts that you would want to prove in real world setting, right? Mm-hmm. So you have a logical assumption, set of assumptions which are posited in a logical manner and logical and systematic manner, and then you want to see whether they explain a certain kind of reality in world, right? Mm-hmm. So when you make your research puzzle, the question that you're trying to solve is also trying to look at certain kind of reality. And in terms of answering a question to that reality, you are giving a particular hypothesis. So every hypothesis has certain basic sets of assumptions. To say that it does not have any basic set of assumptions would be quite misplaced in that sense. So if you are explaining, if you're trying to explain the behavior and the nature of action, state action vis-a-vis other states through this idea of strategic partnership, you have a framework in mind. It's not coming out from any kind of vacuum. So it's important for one to be aware of what are the theoretical formulations already in this field. So you might not want to have a theory and fit your results into it. You might actually be able to come up with an argument which is basically reflective of more than one theory, and therefore you might have a mixed theoretical paradigm at hand at the end of your research. But to say that there is no connect of theory with research is rather misplaced, because as I also said, that there is so much of subjectivity beforehand when we start doing research. This subjectivity is what you need to know and explore. You need to be aware of your biases. Where are you coming from? So a lot of what we are coming from is actually gathered from the already existing field of theories and literature in that particular area. So to be well versed in that particular area of research is to be aware of the theories in that particular area of research. Okay.
Right.
I don't know if that helps a bit, but...
No, it helps. It helps immensely, yeah. Ritesha.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
Thanks.
You're welcome. Yeah.
Ritesha, we don't have any questions in the chat box yet. Does anyone want to ask a question?
Hi, ma'am. I'm Karthik.
Hi.
Am I audible?
Yeah.
So I had this doubt when you said about the Likert scale and about China. So does the Likert scale not work in China because it's culturally ingrained in them to not disagree with any of the propositions or any of the ideas that we put in, because they're too polite. Is that what you're trying to...
No, I'm simply trying to point out that something as inane as Likert scale might not work very accurately in China. Might not work very accurately in China because the respondent might be very wary of strongly agreeing or disagreeing, because that is something that is usually not seen so frequently. Now, we also need to be aware of ourselves as foreign researchers. In that case, we're not a part of that cultural milieu. So, certain situations that might arise and because of which your survey result might not be a very correct representation of what the audience or what the research participants are actually thinking is because of this. It is not to say that Likert scale is very correct in its propositions and its prediction capacity to predict in India or some other part of the world. We need to know the specificities of audiences or participants, cultural context, and that was just an example in that case. Likert scale might work very well for a certain conceptual category which is new to them, and they might not want to, they might not have this fear of putting the balance of scale out of question. So they might respond actually, but to just go and use a research tool which is very much acceptable and viable in a particular country and expect that this tool is going to give the same kind of result in another country is not correct. So when we do survey research in India, we also have to know certain cultural context and specificities here as well. We can't expect the same kind of result as we would from, say, an American research participant group, because they would have a different way of answering. Same thing goes for China. So if you have certain knowledge of the kind of generic cultural response that people are likely to give to you as a foreign researcher, you might be able to do your survey research better. That's all that I'm trying to say.
Again, thank you.
Yeah. Ritesha, since I'm just trying to add on to what Karthik also was asking about, and to what you responded about how your location as a researcher matters and when it comes to interviews and surveys. So how do you address this gap? You're a foreigner, and when you do the interview, of course Chinese are going to kind of be biased in their response to a foreigner. So how do you address this gap of foreigner doing the interview and local Chinese researcher doing the research interview?
Yes, ma'am, I have a similar question on those lines. So as you talked about not using the scale you were talking about, and saying that the Chinese might not respond in a certain way to the foreign researchers. Even my Chinese teacher said the same thing, that whenever you are interviewing a Chinese person, make sure that they do not you don't ask questions that make them uncomfortable and go against their government. They tend to not say anything against their government because there might be actions and consequences for them. So in that matter, there will always be a gap, right? I mean, then we won't be able to find the whole truth, won't we?
Okay, so I'll try to address the three, kind of questions, related questions. Like, with regards to Likert scale, all that I wanted to sort of say was that same research tool might not have same results in every location. So that's one thing. And why? We need to know that there are certain factors behind this why. And then maybe we can recalibrate our scales. We can recalibrate the way we ask our questions. So that is a response to Karthik's question. Rija, we've talked about this, how the idea that there is a foreign researcher changes the response of, the research participant. Now, I would just like to add on to that and say that it's not just in case of China that, it's difficult to do research as a foreigner. I mean, think about a foreigner coming to India and trying to do research in our own country. Definitely, we as Indians are better placed to start doing research. But there also, we see a lot of regional variation. So if you're from a different part of the country and you're trying to do research in another part, it's not as easy as doing a research from the perspective of a local person participating in a local problem, right? So this kind of a variation always exists in any kind of survey research and field research. And what is the best way to bridge the gap? There's never a foolproof way of bridging the gap. There's always going to be a certain distance, as it were, of the researcher from the field. And this distance can best be addressed perhaps by maybe forging certain long-term associations with people from that particular area. So having someone who is helping you to do the research, as they said in case of China, either by institutional affiliation or Quanxi or mutual benefit or whatever strikes the fancy of, or helps the notion of research in a particular individual's case. That perhaps can be one way of addressing the gap. The other way is, of course, to know some language and also be aware of certain cultural, specifics in the case that I said, Pachi and Tachi, how these terms are used. So if you're able to invoke such familiar terms while interacting with the respondents, if you're able to sort of, before even positing your question, you're able to have a working, affable conversation with the respondents, then that always helps, and which is where, the language training comes. So it's always helpful for a foreigner to know the language in any area that she or he's trying to, conduct the field research. So that's one way of addressing. And the third one, which I actually wanted to majorly play upon, was that a lot of us Indian scholars, when we go to China, we have this habit of sticking to Facebook and Twitter and the kind of social media platforms that we are comfortable with in being in India. Now, the point is that none of our peers in China are going to be that active in those platforms in China. So if I've been there for a year, for 6 months, for 3 months, and I've not joined WeChat, I don't know how to use WeChat, I'm going to miss a lot of common interaction with my counterparts and my peer group in China. So one good thing would be to start accepting the fact that there can be a new online existence for oneself. It's not necessary that I'm just Facebooking. It's also important to talk to and, have that kind of a common linkage. That is not to say that any of these would actually bridge the gap entirely. They will not, but we try to our best possible, capacity, right? So I think the third one was that how much can you trust this or no? I missed the third question actually. It was on similar lines and it was like, yeah, you don't ask uncomfortable questions to Chinese nationals because they might be wary of the state. Now, again, if you go to US, do you start asking uncomfortable questions to your American counterpart? You don't. I mean, you don't want to antagonize right in the beginning because you are not from that same context. You might want to put at ease first the respondent and ask their perspective rather than trying to put an antagonistic perspective vis-a-vis their state right from the word go. I mean, if you come to India and you start asking Indians about how good is their government, how bad is their government, how bad is the state of affairs, it's very much likely that neither the American nor the Indian would answer anything against the government, their government, respective governments, in the first go. So to say that this won't happen in China, it's very much predicted because nowhere do I expect anybody to start being antagonistic to their setup, their local, their national setup, from the word go. So unless you have certain, longevity of conversation and certain affability that you've been able to establish with your research participant, it's highly unlikely that your antagonistic question or your question regarding how much they disagree with the government is going to raise, is going to invoke any kind of genuine response. Am I making myself clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yeah, so Ritusha, there's a question in the chat box. I think you have already answered that, you know. So okay. Priyanka was asking that, you know, in response to, I mean, so she has a question that if I have related to the perspective gap we would have while interviewing a Chinese person, would concept of Guangxi help to bridge this gap? I think you have already answered that.
Yeah, yeah. In a way, it will, because you would have a certain network. So, also needs to know how to put forth a question. It can never be in an either or format. So strongly agree and strongly disagree is not something that I actually accept as a viable method in social science. You know, I would not want to put that. I would want to put my question in a different manner altogether.
Okay. Thank you, Ritusha. Do we have any other questions?
Hello. Hello, yeah, Ritusha, this is Mahesh. Yeah.
Yeah, Mahesh.
So you talked about this simulation, you know, simulation of theories. Especially, I'm particularly interested in, you know, empirical models where we can extrapolate or simulate the existing data to predict the outcomes. So you have listed couple of topics. Those are, you know, voting behavior in the Arab Spring, where simulation was used to predict the forecoming events. So do you have other topics in mind as such, which are used in political science, where we can use simulation as an, you know, predominant tool?
It totally depends on you and your research interest. See, the point is that if you're interested in using simulation and you don't have a research puzzle, I would say that now is the time to start, first of all, focusing on a research puzzle. Always prioritizing a method and then going to the, you know, then going to the blackboard to basically find out your question is not a very good strategy. Having a question and then trying to see how many methods can I bring in. Simulation can be one of the methods. So, I mean, I'm not discouraging that one should not use a particular method and one should not stick to the kind of expertise and training that they might have. So, if you're coming from, say, you know, computer kind of background and training and where you have a lot of statistical ability and everything, that's obviously one of the advantages that you should play up to when you're doing your research. But first of all, have a research puzzle. And research puzzle, I mean, I gave you an example that how interwar years had a lot of, you know, practice of simulation going on. This is where game theory became a predominant, you know, method within IR. Whether states will attack each other or not, what are the payoffs and so on and so forth. And because you could do those matrix with regards to state behavior. And this was all coming from realist background, by the way. And it's not as if they were able to simulate and tell that there's going to be a World War II. So there goes the importance of simulation in that sense. It's not mechanical behavior that basically regulates, you know, how states interact with each other. It's rapidly changing because the world is always in flux. It's always fluid. The social, political, economic situation is very much fluid. And you can't really put so much of mechanical version on that. So simulation can be one method, but whether it can be an only and foolproof method to do a particular research, that's highly questionable. Simulation never proved to be 100% true. So one can't really say. If it is used in collaboration with other methods, it's obviously very, very useful. So have your own research puzzle and you see whether this particular method can be brought in some context or the other. You might not want to answer your entire research puzzle through simulation, but a part of your research puzzle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. So I have another question. So you talked about this Beijing consensus model. So could you further elaborate on that? So it appears to me is that in opposition to Washington consensus, it is basically, wanting state capitalism or patriarchy of state to be the predominant force in the market. So is it related to Belt and Road Initiative?
Now, there's a lot of literature on Beijing consensus. When you start looking at how development strategies of communist China were actually perceived by outside world, and by also some of the scholars who, within China who were debating the strategies of development, Beijing consensus, first of all, is not a term that is used by any Chinese. This is basically by Joshua Cooper, someone who's looking at how China is responding to this whole debate regarding development. And he, Cooper, suggests that basically there is an attempt by China to provide a leadership to developing world by presenting an alternative model of development, right? So as opposed to what was happening during Washington Consensus. So I would suggest that get back to certain basic research about this, this whole debate between, you know, the Chinese model of development and the Western world of Western model of development, and how 1976 basically and 78 and all of those ensuing years brought about a change in the China model, and how mixed attributes to, you know, Chinese characteristic of socialism were then proposed, and how then there was also this break into juxtaposition of the Western capitalism and Chinese socialism in the 80s, and how state-owned enterprises basically began functioning as, you know, pseudo, not pseudo, but quasi-capitalist bodies, and how the model basically started shifting its nature every 10 years. So this is a longish kind of a, you know, trajectory of China's political economy, and one needs to look at that. And the context I have provided, perhaps in the best ways of looking more into it, would be to get back to, you know, these terms and the way they originated and the kind of debates that were behind their usage in the first place. So equitable high growth, high quality growth, the context of equitable high quality growth as opposed to what was being promised by the capitalist version of growth at that point in time. These are some of the differing features between Beijing consensus and what was prevalent at that time. These two things are not at the same time frame, you know, Washington consensus and Beijing consensus. So we need to have that kind of, you know, gap in history as well in the context.
Yeah, but like when Beijing consensus talks about this equitable high quality growth,
see, the point is that I have not circulated any reading with regards to this. My suggestion would be before, and I'll be willing to come back for a question answer session itself. No, talk from my side. My point would be that go and read. Don't respond to my, you know, one or two phrases right now. Get back to reading and coming back with that reading. Because right now, whatever I say is just a mere reference. It has no context for you. So unless you put some sort of reading into it, you won't be able to understand even my response in the next 2 seconds in that sense. Won't be any use. So read a bit about Beijing consensus.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are we having any more questions?
Yeah, I have a question. Hi. Yeah, hi Ritusha,
hi.
This is Bihu.
Yeah,
Ritusha, last time when I asked you about the question about the IR theories, the development of non-Western IR theories, and I was specifically mentioning the book by Amitabh Acharya and Barry Buzan. So the book has been divided into perspectives from different countries. So that my question was that, like dividing it in a perspective from different country rather than region, in the sense, I mean, I understand that Asia is a big continent and you can't have a Asian Western Asian IR theory. So that was my one question. That is it like the dividing it into country-specific perspectives makes it an analytical tool rather than the theory? And secondly, my question is like, in the developing world, like in developing countries like India and China, in terms of both economic and development of IR theories in these countries, do you think there's an overlap between the theories and the foreign policies? And IR theories have become more explanatory of the foreign policies carried out by these countries rather than a concrete theory. So, yeah.
See, first of all, I'll get back to that same thing again. Analytical tool, whether the theory is an analytical, it is an analytical tool. I mean, once you have a particular theory, it has been used as an analytical tool to basically represent a certain kind of reality. To say that it has been merely reduced to analytical tool is not a correct way of juxtaposing the method and the methodology. So every time you have a theoretical framework, you're going to use it as an analytical tool in your research. So it is going to happen. It's not as if you leave the theory behind and do some other method and not come back to theory again. You have a theory, you use it. So it is always an analytical tool in the scheme of things. So whether the fact that, you know, countries are, I mean, in Gary Bazan and Amitav Acharya's work, you have perspectives from different countries which basically go into the making of entire non-Western approach to IR. So the juxtaposition there is not between regions and countries in that sense. The juxtaposition is about how most of the IR mainstream theories were emanating and originating from the context of non-Western, from the context of Western locations, right? So you had primarily the example of how power was envisaged and shared and distributed and debated amongst states in Europe, and how then America resurged, and then how the two world wars sort of gave a different light to that entire idea of power distribution across the globe. Now, all of this was basically Western-centric, Eurocentric in their approach, and there was no example that was ever sort of even thought of in terms of colonial countries. So the location of the theories and their context in very much Western hemisphere was something that was being debated by the scholars, and they were saying that when you talk about power distribution, why don't you talk about power asymmetry between the colonial and the non-colonial and the colonizing world? So this kind of power asymmetry, this hierarchy that existed, this is not even being thought of in, you know, the mainstream IR theories of liberalism or realism of that time. So the idea was to start bringing in context and experiences and historical considerations of the colonial world. And therefore, this entire thing that, you know, non-Western hemisphere also deserved a lot of consideration while the formulation of any kind of theory of IR was at hand, gained credence. Now, from where will it come? Will it come from regions or will it come from specific countries? That's a different consideration altogether. It does not really, I mean, finally impact the fact that IR also has to emanate from non-Western world. It can be from regions, it can be from countries, it can be from a group of countries together. So you could have a particular theory from BRICS in that sense, if you know, the BRICS nations start working together and start propounding a school of thought. For instance, Latin Americans did that, and you have ECLA school of thought, and you have the entire dependency theory coming from there, right? And that is not a part of Western IR theories in that sense. It's a response to Western IR theories. So you have dependency, you have core and periphery and everything emanating from developing countries, specifically from Latin America. You have the African theories as well. So sometimes within Africa, certain states would contribute to that, and then it would be later on accepted and would widely have a credence, pan region. Or sometimes it would still be just that particular state's, you know, response to the Western questions of power asymmetry and so on and so forth. So it does not matter if it's an Indian, you know, school of thought, or it's a Egyptian school of thought, or if it's a Japanese school of thought, which is why when I said East Asia, I at least tried to bring in China, Japan and Korea, the way the scholarly responses to IR questions emerged in these locations. And whether we need an East Asian, I think somebody is not muted and there's a lot of disturbance here. So, can anybody whose mic is not muted, please do that, because it's pretty disturbing. Yeah.
Except for Bihu, can everyone mute your mic? Bihu, in fact, can you also mute yourself?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so the fact that the location is not in the sense of whether it's regional or country specific. The location is non-Western. That has been a concern of non-Western theories of IR. Now, interesting question would be, what is the difference between a perspective, an approach, and a theory? So that is something that perhaps I think I would like all of you to go back and read a bit on that. Because now after three lectures, I'll expect, if we have a fourth or a fifth lecture, I'll expect that you've done some background reading on your own and tried to come across these subtle nuances. Because I began with, what is the difference between theory and a methodology? And then what is a good theory? And then what is a method? So these very subtle, fine, you know, distinctions matter a lot. So the same goes for, what is the difference between an approach, a theory, or a perspective? I think if you read a bit more on this, it will help a lot in that context.
Ritusha, you were talking about a book in between, right? The one said that. Yeah, so do you think, I mean, it will be helpful for us, I mean, if you share it with us, maybe, you know?
Yeah, I could do that. Yeah. That's basically doing field work on in China. So I basically consulted that book a lot while I was doing my PhD. So it's very interesting and helpful. So, and also the book that I've already shared with you guys regarding normative theories in IR. If you have time, do go through it. Some of the portions you might have not actually covered earlier. So it's interesting.
Okay.
Yeah.
And should we take more questions? If there are more questions?
If there are more questions, yeah, sure.
Please unmute yourself, you know, before you ask a question. I think that's it. You know, in fact, a lot of people are having connectivity issues as well. You know, they're trying to join, but
the book that I'm saying, I'll just share it on the email with you. It's called "Doing Fieldwork in China," and it's by Maria Heimer and Stig Thorgensen. And the entire PDF is with me, so yeah, I'll be able to share it with you. This came out in 2006.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks, Ritusha. I'll share it with others as well.
And, not a question. Yeah. Not a question, but just a comment. Ma'am,
who is this?
It's Anandita. Not a question, but just a comment. I wanted to thank you for giving these lectures, because I mean, I don't do research in IR. I mostly work on like media studies, and I have a literature background, English literature background. Okay. And right now my research is very cultural studies focused. So when you, some of the references that you gave and the readings you gave on like this entire idea of the middle path were very helpful, because in terms of understanding the Western hegemony, because that is a part of cultural theory as well, when like every second essay that you read references to Foucault in some way or the other.
Yes.
And it becomes a real problem. So like reading these essays has really helped me to navigate as to how we can kind of move out of that in some sense, but also not, you know, not divided that easily into categories like Western and Asian, but at the same time also work with them together while understanding their necessary differences and where they come from. So just wanted to thank you for that, even though
you're welcome. In fact, I think we can always have more discussions now on specific themes and people who think that they can benefit more. For instance, those of you who are interested in doing research, say in China on cultural, particular field or subfields, it would be interesting to have a kind of one-on-one interaction with you guys. Or maybe if 2-3 of you are interested, we can have small clusters and we can have half an hour, you know, web meetings in that sense.
Definitely, because that would be, that would be very like helpful, because
schedule certain meetings in that sense. If you give me a half a page write up that this is what I've been largely working on and this is what I would like to sort of question and have a question and answer session with you, we can always have web meetings which are now smaller in group or maybe exclusively one on one.
If you're open to it, definitely, because some of my own research lately has been like, I've faced some problems with regard to this. Thank you.
Yes. So this is also an invitation to all of you to maybe reach out to me if you want to discuss a particular aspect of the research that you're doing on China. And I'm presuming that you're doing it because you're working right now in with the institute. So you might be writing something, you might be working on something. And if you want to pick my brain or something regarding that, just write me an email and we can schedule a web meeting.
In fact, all of you can write to Ritusha separately as well if you want, or you can, you know, write to, you know, like everyone in general, so that, you know, like all of us can benefit from, you know. So if you have any suggestions regarding, you know, like any future meetings that, you know, you want Ritusha to hold, you can always write to us. We can help organize a meeting. I mean, we can discuss it with Ritusha and, you know, we can, organize a meeting in the future. So I would say, you know, since this is one of the last lectures that we are having, so, you know, please give in your feedback regarding the meeting and, you know, what you would like to cover, you know, if you want something to be covered.
Yeah, so maybe that would be very useful. As Rija is saying that in case you you want some kind of, you know, such a 2 or 3 or 4 lecture series, do let us know exactly what are the topics you have in mind. For instance, the topics that I have in mind, which I have not yet proposed, I'll be doing it with the director and others later on. But I would like to sort of sound it off you, everybody who is right now here, is the political economy, the development perspective in China, the China model per se. And I can sort of look at certain decades, certain last 3 or 4 decades in China and try to look at the political economy of development there. So that's one thing I have in mind, but you are free to sort of suggest. I mean, if it falls within my area of some bit of scholarship, then I'll try my best to come up with some introductory lectures. I hope these 3 lectures were of some use to all of you. And if it left more questions than answers, it's even better, because then I think you're going to go back and read more about them.
Right. So please do write to us so that, you know, give us some suggestions so that, you know, we can finalize on, you know, how do we want to go about in the future classes if you're having one. And I hope we are not having any more questions here. In case we don't have any questions, I'll just, you know, wrap up the meeting in that case.
Yeah, any more questions?
Okay. Yeah, Ritusha, thank you. Thank you so much for the RM classes. I mean, basically, it gave us a kind of a crash course into, you know, IR theories and everything.
Yeah.
I mean, so we are definitely, you know, I think it requires a lot of reading from our side as well to kind of, you know, better able to understand, you know, like back up your, you know, lectures. So I'm hoping that everyone, each one of us goes back and, you know, we do the reading once again. So I mean, and maybe I think we can write to you, you know, once we have done the reading.
Sure.
If we have any queries, we can always write to you, right? Thank you, Ritusha, and all the recordings will be up on the website as soon as the office reopens. The recordings will be up. I mean, can we even share the readings, or can we share a reference list of the
just the reference list? Don't share the readings, because then we'll run into copyright trouble. So now none of the institutes or universities do that. They just put the references.
Reference list. Okay. Yeah, okay. So in that case, we'll just put up a reference list, and maybe Ritusha, if you can share with us a small note, you know,
I'll do that. Yeah. Now that the 3 classes are over, I'm also able to have a better perspective as to how I covered it. And I'll do a small note, which you can put alongside the videos. Yeah.
Okay. And I have asked Anandita to share the recordings with you as well.
That would be great. Yeah.
Okay, Ritusha, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.